So, meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, toll, dass es jetzt schon wieder so voll ist hier. Mein Name ist Bernd Böttiger, ich leite die Klinik für Anästhesiologie und Intensivmedizin an der Uniklinik Köln und ich habe die große Ehre, diese Sitzung, die mir persönlich sehr am Herzen liegt, aus ganz vielen verschiedenen Gründen, zu leiten mit dem Chef der Hamburger Feuerwehr. Und ich bitte Herrn Schwarz, sich einfach zunächst mal selbst vorzustellen.
Ja, vielen Dank. Herr Böttiger, herzlichen Dank. Sehr geehrte Damen, sehr geehrte Herren, ich darf Sie auch herzlich begrüßen jetzt zum Thema Terror- und Großschadensereignisse. Und selbstverständlich habe nicht nur ich jetzt als Leiter der zweitgrößten deutschen Feuerwehr großes Interesse an den Vorträgen, sondern wir alle wissen, dass wir spätestens seit dem 11. September 2001 in einer sicher veränderten Gefahrenlage in der Welt leben. Und insbesondere auch in den Großstädten sind in den letzten Jahren ja immer wieder auch Szenarien, Ereignisse zu verzeichnen gewesen, die mit Terror, mit sonstigen Themenstellungen zu tun gehabt haben, die wir so in der Vergangenheit nicht kannten. Wir mussten nicht nur aus Sicht der Feuerwehr, auch insbesondere aus Sicht der Rettungsdienste uns auf andere Strategien einlassen, mussten, glaube ich, auch viel von militärischen Strukturen lernen. Auch das werden wir heute sicher dann im Laufe der Vorträge noch hören. Haben auch in vielen Bereichen natürlich einen erhöhten Kommunikations- und Koordinationsbedarf, den wir nicht nur an der Einsatzstelle, sondern auch in Stäben, im rückwärtigen Bereich nicht nur trainieren müssen, immer wieder auch optimieren müssen. Selbstverständlich ist auch die Zusammenarbeit mit der Polizei ein ganz zentrales Thema. Wir haben uns auch hier in Hamburg auf den Weg gemacht, entsprechende Konzepte zusammen mit der Polizei und anderen Beteiligten nicht nur zu erdenken, sondern auch immer wieder auszuprobieren und die immer wieder auch vorzuschreiben. Aber ich glaube, das ist auch nur maßgebend, das ist auch nur ein Beispiel dafür, wie sich auch die deutschen Feuerwehren, die deutschen Großstädte in dieser Hinsicht aufgestellt haben. Insofern glaube ich, geht es mir wie Ihnen, dass Sie alle sicher auch ganz gespannt sind auf die Vorträge unserer Referenten. Ich will jetzt auch gar nicht näher darauf eingehen, das wird Herr Böttiger nochmal tun. Auf jeden Fall will ich jetzt nicht viel reden, sondern kann auch nur nochmal sagen, ich darf Sie aus Sicht der Hamburger Feuerwehr sozusagen ja herzlich begrüßen und hoffe natürlich auch nachher noch auf spannende Diskussionen, die sich vielleicht ergeben werden. Aber ich glaube, das Programm ist spannend genug. Vielen Dank.
Vielen Dank, Herr Schwarz. Und es ist mir jetzt eine ganz besondere, auch persönliche Freude, Ihnen einen Menschen vorstellen zu dürfen, den Sie vielleicht zum großen Teil auch schon kennen. Ich kenne Professor Pierre Kalli seit langer Zeit und ich weiß noch, wie aufgeregt ich war, als ich mal auf irgendeinem notfallmedizinischen Kongress in Innsbruck ein Poster hatte. Das ist wirklich schon lange her und er war der Vorsitzende. Seitdem kennen wir uns und wir kennen uns auch aus dem European Resuscitation Council. Professor Kalli wird Englisch sprechen und deswegen wechsle ich jetzt mal ins Englische und change the language to English. And I would like to very cordially welcome Professor Pierre Kalli from Paris. He is the boss of the SAMU, from NODAT system SAMU in Paris. He is also chief of the Department of Anesthesiology in one of the biggest hospitals in Paris, focusing on in major parts on children. And he is responsible for the EMS and for mass casualties and for all this, what could happen and what happened in Paris for, I would say, more than 20 or 25 years. And another special thing is that Pierre Kalli has received the honor of the commander of the Legions of Honor of the French nation. And it is very unique that someone receives this honor during the time he or she is living. In most of the cases, this honor has put to people posthum. So Pierre Kalli, it is a great pleasure and an honor for us that you are here today. You need to be back very early in Paris tonight because your country is on strike from 6 o'clock in the afternoon on today. So therefore, Pierre will leave immediately after his talk due to these reasons. So welcome. We are very much looking forward to your presentation, Pierre.
Thank you, Professor Böttiger. Indeed, it's a great pleasure to be here, and I will not stay, as Bernd say, strike is a national sport in France, and consequently, I will not mix the game. 4 years ago, the most severe terrorist attack we have in France since the Second World War happened. and the SAMU, the EMS system, and the French public hospital of the city of Paris were in the front line. As you know, we have in France a system that is very near the one you have. We have mobile intensive care unit, we have physicians trained to take care of patients with life-threatening emergency and also to work in disaster situation out of the hospital. We have regulating centers, we have close contact with the hospital, all of them works in anesthesiology, critical care, emergency medicine, so we share and exchange information all the day. In fact, the terrorist attack in Paris did not begin in November, but in January. 10 months before, we had two major terrorist attacks. One, you may remember, is the Charlie Hebdo shooting. The staff of this cartoon journal were killed, assassinated by terrorists. And then the terrorists get away and fire randomly people in the city. About 10 dead and a few dozen of victims. The same week, another commando take hostages in the north of Paris, and we have a first week of terrorist attack then. This was for us a major opportunity to revise the plan and be aware that we will have very severe injured patients after terrorist attack with assault weapon, with military weapons. So we adapt the chain, we have products before, going from the site to an advanced medical post and then to the hospital, to the possibility to go straight away to the operating room to do some damage control surgery. And we also train our team, civilian, but trained with military, in order to have on scene the availability of what we call pre-hospital damage control, that means the control of hemorrhage, and to go quickly for the life-saving measure, no more, and then work closely with the surgical team. So this first terrorist attack was the idea to do that, but we have also organizational modification in our thinking. 10 years before, we had a plan in case of multiple bombing in Paris, like in Madrid or like in London. We adapt this plan to the possibility of major shooting, how to coordinate, how to have all our team mobilized in the Paris area at once if it is needed. And we have about 60 teams we can mobilize. So we also work on the fact that there will be a danger. Send all our team to the first site of a multi-site terrorist attack, and that's a nightmare. So we need to coordinate, we need to work together, and all the summit units of the Paris region have begun to work very closely on this scenario and work very closely with the fire brigade, military fire brigade in Paris, with physicians and a lot of EMTs. We have also strengthened the coordination with hospital. In France, all the hospitals have a mass casualty plan. That's the law, but many of them have never used it, and they have not been connected with the EMS system, the mobile intensive care unit, and the medical regulation to do that all together. So we worked on that. We work a lot. And that day, Friday, November 13, at 9 a.m. in the morning, we have what we do very often, drills. The drill was simple. Shooters in the city, 60 victims, hundreds of people injured. And we have worked on that. 60 victims, it looks a lot. Exactly 12 hours after, we were in the middle of the real terrorist attack. In the evening, we had a lot of people killed, a lot of people injured, and we have at least 7 terrorist groups and 3 zones with multiple sites in this zone of terrorist attack. You see the map of Paris, you see the north, you see the east part of Paris, where the majority of the shooting happens. And then the first bomb explodes in the Stade de France. Stade de France, as you know, is the big stadium of Paris. And that day, we were playing against Germany. This terrorist attack was a failure. During the game, a bomb explodes outside the stadium. In fact, the terrorists were late. They have no ticket. They arrive too late, traffic jam. And then they cannot enter. And the decision then was, if something explodes out of a stadium, Everybody stay in, police and army will protect the stadium. And consequently, the free terrorists explode their chemicals bombing out of the place where it was overcrowded, and consequently do very little injured people as compared to what it may have been in a stadium like that. First terrorist attack, failure. Unfortunately, there was also a diversion in Paris. And this diversion was in fact a major attack for us. It was the shootings at the cafe terraces in the center of Paris. And you see the ambulance, multiple shooting on the pavement, corpse everywhere, teams in the middle of the shooting with army, police and fire brigade mix. Some of these shootings happened very near hospital. Here you see Rue Bichat, which is just in front of an hospital, Saint-Louis, which is world famous in terms of oncology and hematology. But there is an emergency room, there is physician and there is surgeon, and they have done their best. They have taken the patient on their back, put them inside the hospital, and began to treat them and do the white plan as it was written in the book. Not far away, another shooting. Dozens of persons. In the Rue de Charonne, you are at 500 meters of Saint-Antoine Hospital, famous hospital for orthopedy. They can do orthopedic surgery anytime. And there were a lot of patients needing orthopedic surgery. We can triage this patient. We have done that and sent there, very near the scene, the patient to the ward that was able to take them immediately in charge and take the right surgery performed. Another point is that we have underestimated the fact that in a city when there is a shooting, you cannot go where you want to go. That means to the hospital. It's unsafe. It's cordoned by the police. There were active shooters. There was police cordoning the street. Don't go there, doctor. It's shooting. So you can do as quickly as you want. And you don't know if you are in a red zone, in a green zone, in a safe place or not. It's impossible to know. The third site, was the Bataclan Theater. In this theater, 1,400 persons were listening to a concert. And the terrorists went in, take all these persons into hostages, and began to shoot them from the stage, like here. It was clearly assassination, and this has taken several hours for the police to enter, for the army, the military police, to help them to neutralize the terrorists. As you see in this map, you see that there was the theater, there was a red with shooting all around, and we also, in that case, used the possibility to make a victim nest protect by forces in order, after that, to evacuate the victim to our system, the advanced medical post, and take them to the hospital quickly and to the hospital that can operate them immediately if it is needed. 3 hours of a stage taking for more than 1,000 people, and clearly that was a nightmare. That night I was indeed on that place. You see the ambulance, you see the way we organized near the scene. We thought we were in a safe place, but we were not. In the middle of the hostage taking, one of the terrorists get out and we received impact of Kalashnikov bullet just near the place where the physician and the patient went. So you see the physician, you don't see the patient. You know why? They are under the physicians. At that time, in the headquarters of the SAMU, we used the coordination for all the forces we have in pre-hospital care. We received a lot of emergency calls. All the services were overwhelmed by thousands of calls in few minutes, and we have then mobilized our system. 60 MICU team were mobilized that night to be heard. We have clearly analyzed all these things, and now, four years ago, we have a lot of data, but we have very quickly give the first result and publish this paper when we observe that among the victims, the mortality arriving in the hospital was low, and that we were able to decrease the inter-hospital transfer, no transfer in the first 2 hours, the 8 few hours, because the patients were sent to hospital, prepared to receive the patient. That's the very important point. Let's have a look now. Most of you are working in hospital. What happens in the largest trauma center we have in Paris, the Pitié-Salpêtrière Hospital. This hospital was immediately alerted and decided to call back a lot of personnel, and it was able to activate simultaneously 10 operating rooms at the same time, operating 53 victims. Pierre Salpêtrière also had organized all his room and places in order to triage the victim a second time, triage on the scene, triage on arrival, a zone for acute emergency, absolute emergency, a zone for relative emergency, where the surgical treatment may be postponed for a few hours. And consequently, they worked very well. The Saint Louis Hospital, the one with the shooting just in front, did its best. And in this hospital, you see on the back of the slide what the post-surgical care room is in case of disaster in France. It's used as a new intensive care unit in order to deal, to triage, and to treat the patient. In this hospital, there were surgeons, but there were no thoracic surgeons. So the idea was to send them surgeons from another public hospital and not to transfer the patient, to use the base we have in order to be more effective. We have published very recently the analysis of all these patients. In this paper, you will see the flowchart of the casualty we have in all the hospitals in Paris, and we'll see also something about the delay. I just want to show you one thing. Some of the patients arrived late in hospital because we are not able to evacuate them. But when they arrive in hospital, all the system was ready to take them, and consequently, when they arrive, if they need surgical hemostasis, it's immediately. No time left, not a minute, they go to the operating room. And we also observe that the patient after the gunshot and the explosion were not exactly the same, and that probably the gunshot wound need more resources, more surgical intervention, and more general surgery at once when they arrive in the hospital. You can have access to all this data and a lot of things. One point we have clearly underestimated was the fact that the consequences psychological for the teams were important. This was a burst of violence, and we observed that the day after, one of the physicians in this meeting, this young physician has been killed. She was at the wrong place. She was with her boyfriend just in front in Hôpital Saint-Louis, the place you've seen the hospital, and she was killed out of first base, but she was killed during that night. All the young physicians that were out, they consider that there was in the middle of a terrible night. What have we learned? The first thing is what I'm doing now. We have to report it, we have to share it. And clearly, the aim is not to say we are good, it's to say what we have done, maybe we'll do better next time, because we can share everything. We have also adapted our medical practice to the fact that civilian teams maybe in the middle of war action. And consequently, we have worked with the military to be able to provide combat casualty care if it is needed, and to do that with all our teams. And you see in our plan now, we have the people, but we have also the possibility that there will be extraction under fire and that the civilian will be in place, the military in another, and the police do its job. We communicate and we share the way we work. This is important because terrorism is clearly something complicated to deal with. Killing, spreading fear and panic means that they will use a lot of various models. And indeed, it will be the truck in the crowd, like in Nice the year after, but it will be a very simple attack or very complicated attack. The only point I'm sure of it is that you will never have the plan you need at the time you need it. So don't work on a plan. The disaster plan have no brain. You have to adapt and to think about the tactics you will use by using your plan as a toolbox and taking the part that is immediately adapt to what you have to do. Second major lesson, coordinate. We have worked on coordination and we don't have worked enough on coordination. And we have changed the French law in possibility to coordinate all the means from the city, the capital, to all the region. That's very important also. And the fact that on a scene, there will be a lot of team of different origin, several police services, army, EMS, police for judicial affairs, and rescue operation all together. If you have not worked with them, it will never work the day we never. So that means we have to train. I remind you that the US, they say, we train like we fight, and we fight like we train. That's exactly true. So we have changed the training, we have adapt new drills. We have also worked on new drills and mass shooting in public places with civilians. We have also worked with the police and the forces. And we have also worked on very simple drills. And I take the opportunity to show you that with a Playmobil box, you can simulate a mass casualties in your hospital. and everybody will look what he has to do, what he has to say. That's inexpensive. Making a drill with all the people you need in a disaster situation, it's a lot of time, a lot of money. This, you can do it immediately at once, and you can work with it. We have published also recommendations. We have training programs, and we have trained all the physicians, including the student. And this is, in my university, the course for terrorist attack this year. You see, it's full up. They are interested. Next and last point will be anticipation. We have to anticipate, and the word is we have to prepare to be surprised. That's all. New scenario. New scenario in the world. If you see one in another place, can you do it? You have to. Terrorist hijacking of an ambulance and exploding in the middle of an hospital. It has been done in other places. That's why in France now, in terms of terrorist attack, if there is one terrorist attack, all the trauma center will be protected immediately by the army, like in places where they are at war. We have also the pediatric mass casualties. In the Nice terrorist attack, there were a lot of children. This is a nightmare in terms of organization of care, and if you have not trained, it's really very difficult to handle. Chemical attack, indeed. From January 2015, 21 terrorist attacks in France. It's the worst thing that happens in our country since the Second World War. So we have to look at our resilience and to participate as physicians to it. And this, what does it mean? It means that if we are able to maintain the quality of care, when the action is clearly aiming disorganization, panic, fear, we are clearly striking the terrorist in the target they wanted to have. If you transform your public not to a soft target, but to people that can react effectively, that will also will be the best way to oppose to the terrorist action. So we have tried to train the population, awareness, training, what you do if you are under attack in many places. It's not finished. It's a long, long, long work, but it's very important. And my conclusion is simple. We have to be adaptable. We have to train and train again. We have to not to be afraid of new strategy. And clearly, if we do all that, we may be resilient and we may share our experience with you. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Pierre, for this very impressive and very important talk on what is your experience with all the attacks in Paris and what are your lessons learned. So we have time for some questions, if you like. And please go to the microphone and use the chance that we have the leading EMS physicians of Paris and France today at DV19 in Hamburg. Any questions? Yes, please. Helia.
Sir, I've got a question. What's your recommendation concerning ID cards for physicians and nurses to access the hospital? What's your recommendation concerning military or police forces to protect this hospital concerning second hit attacks and something like this?
Okay, quick comment on that. My hospital card is with my computer. I have just taken it off because I was here. We were the card all the time. That's the basis. The second point is to train with the forces that will protect you. As you know, we have an organization at France at the time being. The forces that are in Mali, in foreign exploration, they rest in Paris during the terrorist, something like patrolling in the city. But it's very intelligent patrolling, and they make recognizing all the people and all the places. So when they change, they come to the hospital, they come to the SAMU, and they stay for several hours looking at the people, looking not at every face, but the way they look. So if they have to triage them, they can spot quickly the one that it is not at the right place. And we do that. And the strategy is very simple. They have done for Paris what they have done in other places. There is two level of blockade for people, circulation, and two checkpoints. So if something explodes, it will explode at 500 meters from the hospital, far away. And if somebody goes through, there will be another checkpoint to block it. So you wear your card, they know your face, you look what you are, that means a physician and nurse going to work, and we also put in this situation one of two persons from the hospital administration that are able to say this one, yes, and it's not a stolen card or something like that. So it's really part of the job.
It's an important issue. We have discussions on that also in Germany. And if I understood it right, is that nationwide in France that you have this protection of the hospitals in case of terrorist attack?
Yes. The idea is all the time, the Sentinel is the way we call these services, is patrolling. It's random patrol. We never know where they are. And they have a computer that is doing that for that on a national basis. So they do that. And if there is in one place a terrorist attack, immediately they switch to an upper level, and the upper level is protecting first the trauma centers, because the trauma centers will receive the patient, most of the patient, and second to protect the whole other hospitals.
Okay, thank you very much. Are there further questions or comments? Another thing what I have learned in one of your previous talks is that at least in Paris, and maybe it's only in Paris, all the firemen are armed. That was a good thing during the terrorist attacks, because then you had some areas where you were really protected because they had weapons in their fire stations. That is my remembering right?
Yes, you're right. It's very special. The Paris Fire Brigade is military. It's like in Berlin, I think. And the Paris Fire Brigade has few people that still have arms. And consequently, during that night, they deal with the people that were not injured, but that were psychologically shocked. And they were also half naked because they have been charged by the police very quickly, and they don't know where to go. They are lost, their phone, and so on. So if you send these people to the hospital, you create a lot of mess in the hospital. You jam the emergency room and the trauma room because they are in the middle of that. So we decide to take them to the fire station and put in front of the fire station firemen armed in order to make them feel we are protected and we are in a safe place.
Thank you very much, Pierre. Maybe another question from my side, or maybe I don't know whether you have a question. What are the most important things that have been changed since all these attacks in your system, and what have you further developed in your system? I mean, and I also remember that it was really a lucky thing that you had this drill, diese Übung, on the same day in the morning, and in the evening, more or less, something that you have trained really happened.
In fact, it's I don't know if it is lucky, but it's the fact that we are training. And when we train, it may happen the day you are training. It's also the fact that people were mobilized. So to answer precisely to your question, I think that the most important point is that we are now aware it may happen. And it will continue to happen. It's not finished. Unfortunately, it's not finished. So we don't say we've been through and that's over. That's the base point. The second point is that we have not the truth, but somebody and us, we have a part of the truth. If we can share the truth, we can build something strong, and we can create the answer that is adapted even to the worst situation you may encounter.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm again looking around. This is a unique chance to ask questions to one of the, unfortunately, most experienced doctors in the world with this kind of attacks. So if there are no further questions, Pierre, I would like to leave the last words to you. What would you like to tell us before you are going back to Paris and to France?
I will say first that it was a great pleasure to be here. But in terms of medical appreciation, I know that you have been also stricken by a lot of terrorist attack, bigger and smaller. And I think that we physicians, when I say physician, that means teams, we share this burden. We share all this burden. And when you are attacked, when the Belgians are attacked, when Paris is attacked, it's exactly the same. All our community is part of this, and the answer is also a community answer to that. Every time we have something that happens, we try to improve it, to share this improvement, and we raise progressively the level in order to save more life.
Merci beaucoup, messieurs.